What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Wait Your Turn. It is Jordan, and today we're looking at Mage Noir, a spell crafting, spell building, mage dueling, spell wielding card game by Team Mage Noir. So, this game is coming to Kickstarter how soon? As soon as March 16th, Tuesday, a Tuesday. Set your calendars for this one. It has a number of special elements in it, and before I get too deep into this review, or sorry, preview of this game, let me first say the team at Mage Noir, Mage Noir's team, the mages of the inner circle of Mage Noir, they've told me I can say anything I want as long as it's honest. So that means you're going to get nothing but the truth, only the truth, and what? You're going to get the truth, nothing but the truth, and only, what is it? Oh, you're going to get the full truth, nothing but the truth, just the truth. The truth, the full truth, and nothing but the truth. So this early prototype preview that they sent me, it comes with four sample decks. Even though it has six decks of mana, as you see, we have the mineral and arcane mana decks here. This game only came with water, fire, wind, and vegetal card decks for me to base my opinions off of. And so as someone who's played a lot of Magic the Gathering in high school and spent a lot of money on Magic the Gathering cards, I'd say more money than I've currently spent on board games. Is that true? All right, I guess not with most recent pledges, but I've played a lot of Magic the Gathering, starting it around, what is it? Mirrodin Cycle or Phyrexia? I think near the tail end of the Mirrodin Cycle, that's when I got into Magic the Gathering, got hooked. Loved it. This game, it comes from similar roots. In fact, the creators say that this is a love letter to Magic the Gathering, and in some ways, an attempt to improve upon elements that you know and love, and sometimes hate, in Magic the Gathering as well. So, for all intents and purposes, this review is going to cover the pros, the cons, some additional thoughts, and an overall conclusion on whether you should back this game March 16th on Kickstarter, potentially right now. One of the greatest parts of this game is, surprisingly, the mana system. How you access the infinite ether that is promulgating the world. So you have fire, water, arcane, wind, mineral, and vegetal mana that are just swirling around in this invisible ether that only the best mages and potentially Mage Noirs can draw upon to cast their spells, to do nothing else than to incinerate their competition and become the Archmage Noir. I just made that up. To become the best Mage Noir that there ever was. How does this mana system work? So as you can see, these mana decks are separate from the actual decks. The decks themselves are about 40 cards minimum, and in order to access this infinite ether, mages need to pull three cards out of it each turn. So let's say I'm starting my turn, I'm a wind deck player, I'm gonna want a lot of wind. So I can draw one wind, so that's one deck of available ether, a second wind that goes into the second stack, and then a third wind that goes once again back into the first stack of ether. These two piles, these two stacks of ether, form your available ether. Then the mage can then take one or the other pile. So obviously for a first turn, I'm gonna take the two wind ether and the other one remains outside in the available ether for the next player. So these go into my hand or in front of me and they're double-sided so you can't really hide them from another player, but these are now mine to use and to cast and prepare spells. This can also, of course, if you're trying to get a little bit crazier, I don't know if you're mixing or blending your spells, you can do a fire here, you can do a water next, and then you can do an arcane back into your fire pile. So there are only two decks of available ether, but you can draw from any type of mana available in the infinite ether, provided there are enough cards left. In this case, it's not uncommon to actually run out of ether from the infinite ether, surprisingly. So in this case, this gives you a ton of flexibility as well as a nice subtle light mini game as how to manage your mana or the infinite ether in the available ether or available mana pool. Amazing little system right there that really helps you be able to plan ahead as well as hoard mana throughout the course of the game. So at the start of each player's turn, you're drawing and selecting three mana from any pile of your choice, and then selecting one pile from the stacks, from the two stacks of available ether. And that is how mana gathering works. So let me go into a little bit more depth as to why this mana system really works. Number one, you get to choose your ether. Number two, you're always drawing ether. So there's none of this mana blocking nonsense where you just need one more water mana and you can't draw it because it's just randomly shuffled in your deck at the very beginning and you can just be out of the game before it even starts. So in this case, mana is constantly coming in the exact quantities you need, well, nearly need all the time. This mana system has a very nice kind of crescendo over the course of the game where at the very beginning you have maybe 2, 3, 4 mana, but as people are casting more cards and that stored mana is going back into the available ether pool, you're then building up the available ether that's kind of condensing or distilling across the battlefield. So let's say we have this blow spell. It costs 1 wind to play. I'll take that 1 wind that I drew from my first turn and place it underneath this card to prepare it. And so this wind mana and card remain on the battlefield until I use it for another spell, which leads us into the next cool part of this game, which is spell crafting through components. So you're using smaller spells to build up to higher level spells. So this blow or this gust of wind can become a violent wind and then eventually build up into a typhoon over time. It's very, very thematic, flavorful, and appropriate for the crescendoing, building, climactic nature of Mage Noir. So spell crafting, how does it work? So let's say we draw 2 green vegetable mana cards and we have a seed. So the seed costs 1 green mana, as you can see in the top left corner, and you could just cast a seed, and I guess you just eat it, because you can gain 1 health point just by casting this seed. But we're going to save it and use it as a component in a future spell. So we put 1 green mana underneath this card, place it in front of us among all the other prepared spells that we're getting ready to demolish our opponent with, and then let's say we draw some more mana. Let's say over time we accumulate 3 green mana and 1 blue water mana, which allows us to play an animated tree guardian. So this animated tree, not only does it cost 3 green mana and 1 blue water mana, which I've just so timely drawn, we also need 1 seed component. So this seed will go to the side, we'll put it sideways, and then this green mana returns to the available ether in the pile with the fewest amount of mana cards, and then we put 3 green and 1 blue mana below this animated tree card, which becomes a permanent card on the battlefield, which will protect you and deal damage to your opponent as your summon. As you can see, it's very thematic. In this case, a seed is used to grow a tree, and then when you have this tree, you can use this as a component to summon the King of Trees, which requires 1 tree and 5 green vegetal mana. So in this case, you see how it goes from seed to tree to an even larger elder tree in this case. And the same thing, the same pattern flows through all and every single deck. In this case, for the wind deck, you have a blow card, which turns into a wind card. And then you can spend 2 wind cards as components for a typhoon, which creates a pretty powerful effect, which pretty much gets you close to ending the game in a huge climactic outpouring of pure magic. All of this obviously sounds perhaps way too good to be true, and that is where I'll go onto the flip side. So, on the one hand, the good thing is that you have all this mana at your fingertips that is constantly building up, accruing, condensing over here in the available ether pool that is pretty much fair game for either player. And you can kind of game this in a way so you give your opponent like weird mana systems or something. And you can also trade, I believe you can trade 2 mana cards from your hand for any mana card in the larger deck here. So there's also a trade system, kind of like Settlers of Catan or something like that, in which a player, if you have excess mana, you can draw from the available ether very flexibly. So the mana system, super flexible, super useful, and super dynamic as well, while not being too bogged down in complicated mechanics or anything like that. So this system of free mana, essentially, that builds up across the entire game, very good, very solid. The spell crafting, on the other hand, though cool, and does build up into amazing, powerful spells that basically just end the game outright as your steady preparations finally pay off, they can also suffer from component blockage. So we've talked a little bit about how the mana or the availability of mana is the bane, the absolute bane of a well-prepared or a even intelligently crafted Magic the Gathering deck. In this case, the blockage transfers a little bit, slightly, to the components themselves. So let's say you have a hand that has blow, violent wind, and typhoon in your hand. In this case, if you do not have a blow card as a component, you will not be able to cast violent wind, and you will not be able to cast typhoon. In that case, both of these cards basically become dead weight just based on the lack of this simple component that, again, you need to have a good supply in your hand in order to even begin the crescendo. If you can't crawl, you're not going to walk, and for sure, you're not going to run with Mage Noir. So that is one thing that can be frustrating. However, there are a number of mechanics that supplement this and make things a little bit easier. So number one, you can mulligan your first hand, so you can ensure that you have these components in your starting hand. But again, if you're completely unlucky and you shuffle terribly, that could stifle your progress in Mage Noir, this card game. Number two, there are a number of awesome supporting mechanics. Each flavor of color and element has its own array of surprises. The Vegetal deck, for instance, has a number of mechanics that allow you to search for cards from your deck. So if you have the base components that you need, namely seeds, you can play a number of other cards that allow you to search for trees from your deck and put them into your hand. So there's a lot of good card searching in the green element, which is not entirely too much of a departure from the green Magic the Gathering deck. And then you have wind cards that actually let you cycle through cards. So what does that mean? It means you can play blow and then violent wind, and then the blow card will go back into your deck third from the top, and then you can draw it again and keep reusing components in a very efficient way. Wind doesn't have as much damage output as, let's say, the fire deck, for instance, but in this case, the efficiency is very fun, in which cards keep coming back and boomeranging back into your hand just when you need them. Next is this water deck, which is extremely powerful. We'll get into card balance and how I perceived the elements interacting with each other in a moment. But with this water deck, you have this amazing ability of being able to continually be able to move around water mana from card to card with different effects. If this card has more water on it, you may be able to kind of bank that out for a tremendous amount of damage in a deluge or flood of water mana. And finally, the fire deck, it deals a lot of direct damage as well as a lot of self-inflicted damage in exchange for power. So these are the basic flavors of these starting elements, and the card crafting, though good, requires sometimes a burdensome requirement of components that you may or may not have at the right time. However, mana is in perfect excess in this case. So regarding Mage Noir's various elemental decks, it's very refreshing. The water deck, I mean, having played a lot of Magic the Gathering, I am up front, I'm more of a red and green, maybe just pure green, maybe some black a little bit, but just like straightforward Magic the Gathering colors, gruel, that's my bread and butter. After playing this game, I was surprised to find how much I enjoyed playing blue, the water deck, and how different it felt from the normal control versus aggro kind of dichotomy that's in Magic the Gathering. I really appreciate the flexibility that each one had, especially the wind, being able to not only cycle cards back into your deck, but you play a card that allows you to activate the card that you spent for it, and activating the component cost. So let's say you play Tornado. So Tornado, it has a cost of 1 wind and 3 air mana. And in this case, you'd ordinarily need to expend a wind card to play this card. But in addition to playing this card, it activates the effect of the component you've spent on it. So you get like a 2-for-1 super efficient card play system that just pays dividends. So the wind system, the water system, amazing. And then the green vegetal system, it's a little bit more ponderous and slow, but the idea of growing things from seed into impenetrable forest is not lost on me. And the flavor is really good as you build up this kind of sprawl of undergrowth that just chokes out your opponent over time. I've gushed over this game tremendously now, and I haven't even mentioned the goal of the game. The goal of the game is to deal 20 damage to your opponent, or every opponent, every mage starts with 20 hit points in this game, which you're trying to whittle down to zero. If you do so, you are the winner. So ultimately, what I really appreciate from this game is that each color and element in this game was a refreshing take on these elements that we've seen before in other card games. Water being, instead of just being a kind of mind control-like substance, it's now fluid and more rooted in the actual properties of water itself, wind is, it's light, it's also, again, super flexible and elemental, and it keeps recurring and coming back and cycling through like a miniature tornado. Earth is very stalwart. It's one of the few decks that actually has hit points on the monster cards and can summon multiple ways to protect your health points physically, as well as choke out other mages. And then finally, the fire deck is probably the most straightforward, but also unfortunately the most underpowered deck at the moment, which just deals straightforward damage. And so that leads into my next point about the elemental balance. So remember, this is a prototype, but essentially there is, at this point, this day of February 26, 2021, there is a little bit of power imbalance between each of these elements. Currently, at this point, water is surprisingly the best, most powerful deck due to the gradual buildup of water mana that can then be spent for double damage at an easy, in a very simple, straightforward combo that basically works every single time. Air is the next strongest through its cyclical abilities and card cycling that deal incremental but significant amounts of damage over time, turn after turn, extremely reliably. The vegetation deck is the third strongest, mainly due to the fact that it's it creates high levels of protection as well as pretty good damage output and card searching. And then lastly, the fire deck. The fire deck needs a little work. They told me that they originally it was actually way too powerful, but then they nerfed it tremendously, especially increasing the component cost, which can be felt severely acutely. So the fire deck is, even though the most straightforward, it is the slowest, surprisingly, and actually in some ways the least aggressive. So there's still some work that needs to be done. I talked with one of the designers, and he said that the game mechanically is about 80% there, which is pretty good considering the level of depth, flavor, and thematic tie-ins to each of these elements and how different it feels from Magic the Gathering. I was very impressed. Another thing that I'll throw in there, another con for why you may not want to back this game, is that the tempo is very different from Magic the Gathering. Magic the Gathering has a very aggressive emphasis on turn 1, turn 2, turn 3 kind of scenarios. In this case, the first, second, and third turn, though important, isn't as important as potentially the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th turn, as you're going to get into a longer, more gradual game as each mage is kind of ramping up in power. So you can definitely feel that each mage is like, you know, chanting incantations and waving their hands, gathering elements to create this Kamehameha of awesomeness. So the feeling and flavor between each of these decks is very mage-like. This isn't a direct confrontation of warriors going at each other with swords and spears. This is a kind of a almost a slow and subtle dance of incantations and enchantments that creates a wonderful web of powerful spell casting. So the impact of this game comes from your preparations leading up into the final endgame, where each mage will see if their spell weaving has paid off. Did I enjoy it? Yeah, it was very interesting to play and very fun to see how each deck had its own signature. And that is just from my basic experiences with these four starting elements: fire, water, wind, earth, and they conveyed and communicated very clearly what they're all about. And that's not even getting into the arcane magic, which is a manipulation of space and time, and mineral magic, which represents more hand-to-hand combat battle mages. So super intriguing what the expansions will bring when this game actually hits Kickstarter, and finally hits Kickstarter March 16th. Overall, this game, it hits a lot of good notes. The climactic conclusion to each game is very satisfying because, you know, you're building it up, you're kind of fanning a flame into a raging inferno, you're cultivating these seeds into an overwhelming forest, you're taking drops of water and turning them into a flood, or taking a slight gust of air and turning that into a typhoon. So the flavor is there, the theme is there, the mechanics are solid. Could use a little tweaking on the component cost over here for the fire deck, but ultimately Mage Noir was a great experience, and should you back it, should you consider it, I'd say yeah. I'd say this is worth looking into. Again, it's not a board game, it's a card game, But it does have a number of good surprises for 1 to 2 and potentially more players over time. I'm not entirely sure where that stands. So, Mage Noir is a clever evolution of Magic the Gathering that takes what you know and makes it better. That's what I'll say for that. And I look forward to seeing it March 16th on Kickstarter. So thanks everyone for watching. I hope you enjoyed this. And go ahead to subscribe and check out their link for their Kickstarter campaign, which I'll put below when it actually launches. So thank you all for watching, and I hope you all have a wonderful day. So thank you for watching. Thank you for waiting. And now it's your turn.